Oh, hi. You caught me looking at records. Speaking of records, let's talk about records. Welcome to Comic Tropes, I'm your host Chris. These days, I think it could easily be argued that we comic book fans are a little bit spoiled in terms of how much extra stuff we have based on our favorite comic books. I'm talking about all the adaptations into television, film, video games, toys. I mean, there's just so many licensing opportunities. But when you look at the entire lifetime of comic books here in America, that's only been that way for about half the time. If we go back before that, well, we start to realize that it's a relatively new phenomenon. Comics in the 40s inspired serials before movies, and some simple toys as well as radio shows. But for the most part, comic book characters stayed in comic books until about the 1970s. DC had a live-action Superman show in the 50s, and Marvel had a few animated shows about its characters at the end of the 60s, including a fairly well-remembered Spider-Man adaptation thanks to its catchy theme song. Spider-Man, Spider-Man, friendly neighborhood Spider-Man. But licensing and merchandising opportunities exploded in the 70s, when both Marvel and DC licensed their characters to Mego, who manufactured dolls,
Falcon, the winged black superhero,
and Peter Pan Records, who put out original comic books with a full cast audio record to accompany it. Some of these stories weren't officially part of the comic's continuity, but to many kids throughout the 70s, it was their first introduction to characters like Batman or Spider-Man. Let's go back even further in time to set the stage. In the late 1920s, Daniel Kaysen founded the Synthetics Plastics Company, which began by providing buttons and other things to the garment industry, but soon grew to create poker chips and other molded plastic items. Shortly after World War II, Kaysen realized his presses could be used to create records, and he began producing them. The label was named Peter Pan Records, and they produced children's songs and stories. In 1948, they began licensing popular children's characters like Looney Tunes and the G.I. Joe toy line. It was a tremendous success. After they produced records for characters like Popeye and Scooby-Doo, they turned their eye to producing stories about superheroes and science fiction. And in the early 70s, they formed an imprint called Power Records. Power Records would go on to create books and records featuring Batman, Captain America, Planet of the Apes, Star Trek, and many more. A lot of the Marvel comics tended to be adaptations of their then-current comics, but the DC comic stories were mostly original. Now, technically, they weren't in continuity, but to kids reading them, they were as real as any other comic book. And these days, some of them are actually a little bit rare. Let's go on eBay and take a look at what they're going for. We've got a few completed listings here that we can see went for around 70 bucks, 60 bucks. Spider-Man, Fantastic Four, Superman, Batman. Not all of them go for this much, but a few are valuable to collectors. Let's see what other comics are going for a lot since we've got eBay open. Huh. This guy says he has a printing error that has the Marvel comic Marvel 2-in-1 number 74 that was printed with a new Teen Titans number 6 cover. Never heard of that one before, and he's asking for over $1 million. Right. I think this guy needs to understand that rare doesn't necessarily mean valuable, because it doesn't necessarily mean in demand. I could pinch off a turd right now that looks exactly like Stan Lee, and I guarantee none of you out there would want to pay $1 million for it. I mean, and we're also just having to take this guy's word at it, because I've never heard of this particular error. There's no documentation on it. Certainly no normal person could take a saddle stitch stapler and move a DC cover to a Marvel comic, right? So, yeah, definitely. $1 million. Good investment. Good investment. Let's get back to the Power Records comics. Many of the news stories were illustrated by the same talent that worked on the comics at the time. For instance, a Conan story was illustrated by John Buscema, the artist on the comic. One comic that stands out as memorable is the Captain America story called And a Phoenix Shall Arise. The story is written by Tony Isabella and illustrated by Sal Buscema, and it's the origin for the second modern-day Baron Zemo. But the main reason it's memorable is that samples of the record were used by Eminem in his 2013 hit Rap God.
Look, I was going to go easy on you, not to hurt your feelings, but I'm only going to get this one chance.
Eminem has used samples from the Captain America and Fantastic Four records in his song Groundhog Day and Get Up by Slaughterhouse, which he produced. And he's not the only rapper who grew up inspired by these records. The Beatnuts used a sample from a Wonder Woman record to provide the hook for Watch Out Now.
Listen to the first verse.
Watch out now.
Hey yo, my song's on, I gotta get my...
And the Ghetto Boys used a sample from a Batman record for Mind of a Lunatic.
He's a paranoid who's a menace to our society.
I actually remember hearing that one back in 1989 and sort of being surprised that it wasn't a bigger hit, because the live-action Batman movie came out that year and Batmania was insane. I remember everyone in my school seemed to have a Batman or a Joker t-shirt, and they had no idea who the character was. They'd never read the comics. Everybody was just pumped for Batman, but I don't really remember anybody else knowing about the Ghetto Boys hit that year. The DC stories for Power Records, as well as the Star Trek stories, are remembered for having some great artwork. Power Records hired superstar artist Neal Adams Studio to create the original stories. Neal had teamed up with DC Comics editor Dick Giordano to create Continuity Associates, an independent comics studio that created a lot of comics-related artwork for ad agencies and storyboards for movie and TV productions. Neal himself illustrated stories for Batman and Star Trek. However, the Star Trek comics are notable for having a lot of coloring mistakes, like consistently coloring Lieutenant Sulu as a black man and Uhura as a white woman. While it's definitely a mistake, I'm not sure if it's an intentional mistake or not, because it's not like they get one or two panels wrong. There's a second story illustrated by Sal Buscema that features the Enterprise crew battling a wizard and a barbarian that looks suspiciously like Conan. And Uhura and Sulu are consistently illustrated and colored as a white woman and a black man, respectively. I honestly can't see why they would intentionally change the race of those two characters. I don't see the benefit to them in doing so. In fact, if anything, you'd think it would annoy Star Trek fans who are very familiar with and love those characters. So, I don't know. The fact is, I can't find anyone who's ever gone on the record to explain why it was done that way. And yes, that was a pun, so I'll give you another 10 seconds or so to recover from laughing. I don't want to hurt you. And then we'll move on. Not every record came with a comic book. Several Spider-Man stories didn't have one. One was an adaptation of a comic book, and one was an original story. That was a bizarre original tale in which a man injects iguana blood into himself, which turns him into a dragon man that can breathe fire. Spider-Man eventually knocks him off a roof, and when he hits the ground, it turns him into an iguana that Spidey lets run off. So the overall quality was a bit hit and miss, but that's actually not the reason why Power Records ceased to exist, and they did cease to exist by the end of the decade. In fact, what happened was they made the same mistake that Mego did, and that was neither one of them saw the potential of Star Wars, and they both passed on that license. And that license was humongous. So, 1978, 1979, Star Wars was king. Other publishers had Star Wars comics, Star Wars audio, like they had original radio plays with most of the cast in them. Those were a huge hit. They had, of course, the toy line. Massive, massive successes, and it passed them by. The other thing is, it was a novelty. You know, a record was a novelty, but the reason it was popular at the time was in the 70s, we didn't have cable TV. We didn't have VHS tapes to rewatch our favorite cartoons. We could listen again and again to these records. So while it was a novelty, it was a new immersive experience, and that's sort of why it was popular for a relatively brief time throughout the 70s. Because of the trouble of licensing them, I wouldn't ever expect these stories to be re-released. That said, sometimes I'm surprised that there aren't more publishers, especially independent publishers, who haven't taken advantage of the fact that it's very easy these days to create and release a podcast, and basically use the same idea. It could be advertising for your comic, it could be an added bonus for certain comics. Sometimes I'm surprised that doesn't exist. Actually, maybe it does, and I just haven't caught it yet. So if you know of a comic that has created something like a podcast as an added bonus, definitely reply in the comments. Let me know about that. I won't be surprised if somebody does something like that in the near future. Anyway, with that said, let's take a look at what kind of fan art I got this week. Here's a piece from a viewer in Italy who goes by the handle Painmaster. He's created a logo of sorts, and I honestly love it. This is fantastic. So Painmaster was the only person to send in actual fan art for the channel this week, and if you send fan art that's based on this channel, I will enter you in a weekly drawing for a Gachapon prize. They're all in here. I picked them up in Japan myself. Just send it to comictropes@gmail.com. If you want me to include your name or your website, social media handle, anything like that, just include that in the email and I'll do that. Painmaster, you are the only one, so I'm just reaching in. I'm not looking at what I'm drawing. What would this be? This looks like it might be based on Pacific Rim. That's my best guess. I think that that's a robot from Pacific Rim. Anyway, I'll send that your way as soon as I get your address. Thank you very much. You know what? I got a lot of really wonderful, super supportive emails this week. So thank you, all of you. Like, that was just... it was just a really nice week. The channel hit some pretty explosive growth. We got a lot of new patrons. I'm very grateful for all of that. Like, sincerely, thank you. You're helping make this a community. And I find the people that I'm talking to in the live streams and on social media, everybody so far seems really kind and smart, and they just happen to love, you know, the medium of comic books. Like, look at all these crazy comics that I got here. I love them. Even if they're crummy comics or if they're great comics, I love them. I love comics. I think it's my personal favorite storytelling medium. So I just love investigating strange pieces of history or looking at the techniques of certain creators. I love doing that. I hope you enjoy seeing it as well. Thank you so much for your support. It's really exciting to see the channel going through such explosive growth. I know this episode was a little shorter than some, so I've actually got a treat. I've got another episode coming this week, another short episode. Gonna give you two short episodes instead of one big one. It was a little easier for me, very busy. I hope you understand. Definitely have some big things planned in the near future. So stick with us. We've got some wonderful creators we're gonna be talking about. We've got some fascinating, strange, obscure bits of comic book history that I'm going to bring you, and I can't wait. Please stay with me. Thank you for your support. And you know what? Why don't you keep reading comics? Do that. Keep reading comics.